Welcome to the American Hospital Association's webinar for trustees, New Approaches to Effective Board Decision Making. I am pleased to introduce our presenter, Jamie Orlikoff. Jamie Orlikoff is president of Orlikoff & Associates, an international consulting firm specializing in healthcare governance and leadership, strategy, quality, and organizational development. Long recognized as one of the leading experts in the governance field, Jamie has consulted with hospitals and systems in 11 countries, and since 1985 has worked with hospital and system governing boards to strengthen their overall effectiveness and their oversight of strategy and quality. He has served on hospital, college, and civic boards and is currently a member of the St. Charles Health System Board of Bend, Oregon. It is now my pleasure to turn the program over to Jamie Orlikoff.
Thank you very much and welcome everyone to this webinar on one of the most important but surprisingly frequently neglected topics of governance, which is how boards make decisions. And that's what will be the topic of this conversation, specifically focusing on some new techniques and new approaches and new tools to increase a board's ability to make effective and efficient decisions. Before we get started, just wanted to emphasize this session is being brought to you by the American Hospital Association Trustee Services area, and they have a tremendous amount of useful resources on their website, including several articles that expand on the topic and give samples of the decision-making tools that I will be reviewing with you today. I've already been introduced, so this is just my bio and contact information. So let's just jump into the topic. And let's consider boards as decision-making groups. So what I'm going to talk about certainly applies to boards, but it applies to really any group in a healthcare organization that is tasked with making a decision. So this could apply to board committees. It could also apply to medical executive committees or boards of clinically integrated networks, and certainly to executive teams as well. So one of the first principles we think about when we think about board decision-making or any team decision-making is that the first thing that any effective board or other decision-making body does is decide how it will make decisions. And I know that sounds very meta or kind of circular, but it's extremely important. And surprisingly, the vast majority of boards never have this conversation, or if they've had it, it's receded into the distant past and they never repeat it. So good boards will fairly frequently, at least once a year, at least once every 2 years, have a conversation among themselves about how they make decisions. This is extremely important because it gives a board not only the tools to approach different types of decisions, but also reinforces that they are in charge of their own decision-making processes. And as you consider decision-making, unfortunately what happens is in the vast majority of American boards, we default to kind of a sixth grade understanding of Robert's Rules of Order that we learned in a civics class. And so the vast majority of boards only have one approach to making decisions, and that is an explicit vote, roll call vote or raising hands with the notion that a simple majority rules. And boards will use that same mechanism to make a decision approving the minutes of the last meeting as they will to approve a major merger. So we have a very limited and therefore limiting approach to decision making. There's another kind of implicit cultural characteristic of board decision making in the United States, which is unanimity. The expectation is by the time a decision comes to the board, that it's either been vetted sufficiently by whatever group made the recommendation, that the expectation is that the board will approve this decision unanimously. And so as a result, you have many situations where boards will make a unanimous decision where many board members have serious questions about the decision or don't really support it, and this lack of support then becomes manifest later when the issue is implemented. And this can frequently result in all types of challenges, not the least of which is unplanned and unnecessary CEO turnover. So what are other approaches that we can use to move away from this simple majority rules, explicit yes or no binary decision, culture of unanimity in boards? And that's that other thing I want to emphasize before we jump in. This other characteristic of board decision-making is that it's binary. A board only has two options when it makes a decision, typically, and that is to vote yes or no. Now, this implies that a lot of work has gone into framing the issue, and frequently that work is appropriately done below the level of the board. But increasingly, and especially for big, challenging, generative, or strategic decisions, this work should be done at the board itself, which implies a decision-making process that is not binary, but rather that actually multiplies alternatives. And so there are a whole different variety of ways of approaching this really fascinating topic of how a board makes effective decisions. So let's consider some of them. First thing we have to understand is that unanimity does not always signal consensus, nor does it signal uniform board agreement or understanding. And perhaps the best example of this is a quote taken from Alfred Sloan when he was the chairman and chief executive officer of General Motors, where he had taken a very complex proposal and presented it to his board, and the board immediately voted to approve it. With no discussion, no debate, no questions of him, they just voted to approve it unanimously. And his response was, he looked at the board, who at the time were all men, and he said, "Gentlemen, I take it that we are in complete agreement on the decision here. Then I propose that we postpone further discussion to give ourselves time to develop disagreement and perhaps gain some understanding of what the decision is all about." And what Sloan was suggesting was what Peter Drucker, several decades later, made very explicit. And he said, to make more effective decisions, you want to focus on developing disagreement rather than consensus. Disagreement provides alternatives and makes you think more deeply about the issue. In fact, if you don't have disagreement, you are not ready to make a decision. Now, that's an extremely important point because many boards have an implicit, unspoken culture of unanimity, where disagreement is regarded as being, you know, obstructionist or contrary or, you know, or not being with the program or not being a member of the team. So that's one of the first things we have to understand. And this has to kind of bump up against that binary culture of the board has one choice, and that's approve or disapprove, vote yes or vote no. So that's the first thing we have to understand is, does your board have an implicit culture of unanimity? And one way, you know, of checking that is don't rely on your memory, but just go back and take a look at, you know, the board minutes for the last couple of years and see how many of the board's votes were unanimous. And the longer back you can go without finding a no vote or an abstention, the more that speaks to your board having a culture of unanimity. And that's one of the first things that you'll have to address. Is it okay for someone to vote no? Is it okay for someone to express a dissenting opinion? You know, and if so, why hasn't that been done in the past? So that's one of the first things that we think about. Then we come into, you know, some of the very specific techniques. And now what we're talking about are different ways that a board can approach making decisions. And the more techniques the board has in its toolbox, the more arrows it has in its armamentarium, the better able it will be to tailor different decision-making techniques to decisions of different magnitudes. And that then becomes a very, very important point. Not only do really good boards have different ways of making decisions, but they understand that decisions of different magnitudes are likely to benefit from, if not require, different decision-making techniques. So a relatively pro forma simple decision approving the minutes of the last meeting might, you know, be fine with a binary yes or no, raise your hand technique. Whereas a major decision, approving a strategic plan or making a decision about consummating a merger or some type of a joint venture or affiliation, is a decision of a different magnitude, which will have much more significant consequences and therefore might benefit from a different decision-making technique. So with that as kind of a thesis premise, I'd like to spend the rest of this webinar actually walking through four or five different types of decision-making techniques for boards to consider. And these, you know, are summarized in this visual, and they are decision sequencing, the use of non-binding straw poll votes, the use of variable supermajority vote requirements for different decisions, the use of secret ballots, and a board considering that the possibility of a tie vote exists, and prospectively determining how it might respond if it ever confronts a tie vote. So let's consider each of these in a little bit more detail. So the first one is decision sequencing. And what this simply relates to is that many boards find themselves making rushed decisions. They're asked to make a relatively major decision at the first meeting where the issue is being presented to and discussed by the full board. Now, frequently this will be presented as the management team has spent a year deliberating this issue, or the finance committee of the board has spent 6 months working on this issue. And the implication of that is, so all of you who are not on the finance committee should respect what this committee has done and just vote to approve it. The committee or the medical staff or management may have spent a lot of time on the issue, but if I'm not a member of any of those groups, this is the first time that I, as a board member, have heard that issue or heard about the issue or heard the rationale for the recommendation. And asking me to vote on it when it's the first time I have heard it and the first time that several other of my board colleagues have heard it is an inappropriate, limited approach to making decisions. And so as a result, what many boards will do is they will create a rule where they will say, we recognize that occasionally there will be emergencies, or there will be great time-limited opportunities where it's necessary for us as a board to make a decision at the same meeting where the issue is first presented. But we want this to be the exception, not the rule. And what we want the rule to be is that we want to use a decision sequencing policy, which is that any group reporting to the board or making a recommendation for a board decision, any group, whether it's management, a board committee, a clinical group, medical staff, is requested to tee up the issue, tee up the recommendation, at least one or two meetings before the board will actually make the decision. So as an example, the issue may be presented to the board at the September meeting. And the issue is outlined and the recommendation is given. And then the vote is not scheduled till the October or November meeting of the board. This gives the board the opportunity to sleep on it. It affords them the opportunity to request more information. It also gives them the opportunity to kind of fine-tune any questions they may have so that those questions can be posed to the recommending body and discussed at the next meeting before a decision. And this tends to generate much better, not only decisions, but a much greater sense of board ownership over the decision, which is very, very important, so that 6 months, a year later, after the decision has been implemented, if there is some negative pushback relating to that decision, which there are frequently in challenging decisions, the board can step up and say, no, we own that decision, we support that decision, and defend that decision to the various constituency groups. So that's one technique. Another technique, which is surprisingly very useful for very many boards, is the use of non-binding straw poll votes. And this is just when the issue is first being presented, the board is asked, what's their preliminary take on this issue? How many are in support? How many are not? Just to get a sense of where the board members are. And so, when you do this type of a non-binding straw poll vote, the chair can say, look, we're evenly divided, or look, we're all trending toward this side of the issue. Isn't that interesting? Now let's talk about it. Now, what's interesting about this is it's very counterintuitive, because the way most votes are held, the board will discuss the issue first, and the only way you can tell, how people are feeling are by the questions they ask or the statements they make about the issue. And then the vote is held, and that's when what the final determination is going to be. And many people think if you take a straw poll vote at the beginning of the conversation, which is almost a reversal of the process, it will lock people into a position. In fact, and very counterintuitively, the research shows that the opposite is true, that the way we do it now tends to lock people into a position, that by the questions I may ask as a board member or the statements I make, it kind of locks me into a position and prohibits me from really opening my mind and listening to the conversation and perhaps engaging in a process to synthesize a better decision. So what the straw poll vote technique does is just kind of frees people up to say, well, here's how I'm preliminarily thinking about the issue. I'm kind of in favor about the issue. Now let's discuss it. And as counterintuitive as it may seem, that opens my mind and makes me more willing to either adopt a different perspective or participate in kind of refining the vote or synthesizing a different perspective. So this is a very, very useful technique, very, very easy to do, and boards that do it, you know, find that it kind of lets the air out of the issue, that it kind of clears the deck so that when the issue is discussed, there are no hidden agendas and there are no kind of interpretations by tone of voice or other issues for board members to glean where their colleagues are coming from, and really then can kind of create a better context for better board decision making. Now, this next one is called fistify voting, and this is a really powerful technique which kind of flies in the face of the typical binary approach to board decisions. As I said at the introduction of this webinar, most boards just take a binary approach to voting. You either vote yes or no, and that's it. And the implication is if you vote yes, you're all in. And yet many of us, if not all of us, who've ever voted on an issue that we had some concerns about, may have voted yes for an issue which we had significant concerns about or serious doubts about. So binary voting is akin to brake lights on a freeway. If you're driving on an expressway and the car in front of you, the brake lights come on, all you know is that that driver has engaged their brake. You cannot tell whether it's a light tap of the brakes or whether it's a panic stop by the brake lights alone. The only way you can determine that is from other cues. Does every other car in front of you have the brake lights on? Is smoke coming from the rear tires? Has the front end depressed significantly? All of those things would indicate a panic stop. But just by the brake lights, you have no idea. And by that same token, just because I raise my hand to vote yes during a board meeting, you have no idea. Am I 100% committed to the issue? Is it tepid support? Am I really opposed to the issue? But because we have a culture of unanimity and we're having a rushed vote, I don't have time to ask questions or express my opinion, and maybe, you know, my lack of comfort with the vote is still kind of intuitive or unconscious, and I haven't had the ability yet to figure out a way of expressing it intelligently. So you can't tell. So fistify voting addresses this, and here in the fistify technique, rather than only one option, vote yes or vote no, board members have six options to vote. So, you know, when the chair says all in favor, a board member can do one of six things. They can raise a fist, and a fist means no, no in thunder. I'm voting no. I'm completely opposed to this issue. The next option is one finger. A single finger means that I am, you know, I've got just the minimum level, the bare minimum of support for this issue, but I'm, you know, in a binary vote, I'd probably vote no. Two fingers means I've got a little bit more support, but I'm still tepid. I'm more negative than positive. If I raise three fingers, it means, well, I'm more positive than negative, but it's much less than full support. I'm kind of on the fence. Four fingers means that I've got very, very positive commitment to the vote, and five fingers means wholehearted support. I'm all in. So the benefit of this technique is you can say, let's do a fistify vote, and then look around the room and see, is everyone fours and fives, or is everyone threes and, or are some people fives and some people ones? And if some people are voting five and some people are voting one, you've got a very strong division of opinion, and it's worth some more conversation. So this technique is very, very useful, and it can be used in several ways. First of all, it can be done as part of a non-binding straw poll process vote at the beginning of the discussion. So you can not only say, let's see where we are in the issue, but you can determine, wow, we're trending positive, but most of us are three or four. It's not like we're all in on this issue, so we need to talk about it. Or you can say, wow, we're really divided on this issue. Another technique that you can use is to use the fist to five for the final vote. And I've seen some boards say, we're going to pick a threshold. The average must be 3.5, or the average must be 4 in order for this vote to proceed. So there are a variety of ways you can use it, but it's especially useful in that preliminary straw poll vote decision because it really signals where the board members are in their support, and then you can use another technique, which is to have meaningful conversation based on the 5-to-5 vote. So, you know, what many boards will do is they'll say, all right, we've done the 5-to-5 vote. We have a couple of fives. Most of us are fours. We have a couple of twos, and one individual voted one. So let's ask the people who voted one or two to let us know why they feel the way they feel. Anne, would you please tell us why you voted one and what your concerns are, and so on. And then when you come to the people who may have voted three, you can say, Mike, what is it about the issue that concerns you, and what would it take to get you to move your vote from a 3 to a 4? Is there something that can be done to modify this vote? And then you have conversation about it. And then, just as Peter Drucker and Alfred Sloan talked about, the board develops a greater understanding of the issue and of the concerns of their colleagues, which can then enable them to either make the decision in front of them with a fuller understanding of the concerns and the implications, or to modify the decision, to move away from a binary yes, we approve, or no, we reject, to a, well, we largely approve, but if we tweak it this way, now we're all in. And that can be incredibly powerful for the variety of reasons that I've described. So that's a very, very, very useful technique, and pretty much every board I've seen adopt that technique raves about it later. They find it very, very kind of liberating and making their decisions much less pro forma and much more meaningful and creating much more ownership over the decision. So another technique is one which kind of exists but is in the far recesses of the bylaws or the law, and this is what's called a supermajority requirement. And frequently, state laws, non-for-profit corporation acts, will specify that certain decisions must have a supermajority of the board in order to be effective or to be ratified, like selling the assets of the organization or converting a not-for-profit tax-exempt organization to a for-profit organization. Likewise, many bylaws of organizations will also specify one or two votes that may require a supermajority vote of the board, typically removing a board member from office or changing the bylaws, something like that. But what these requirements are explicit statements that this particular issue, whether it's selling the organization or removing a board member from office or changing the bylaws, is so important that it demands a different decision-making process and a higher decision-making threshold. And so another technique is just recognizing this, and for decisions which are not required to have a supermajority, like two-thirds of the voting members or three-quarters of the voting members or 60% or some other threshold above 51%, boards can say, gee, this issue seems pretty important to us. Do you think it's useful for us to establish a supermajority threshold? And so by doing that, and this is kind of very, very interesting and subtle, but by doing this, simply discussing whether a decision is significant enough to warrant a supermajority threshold is very, very valuable because it heightens the board's awareness of their decision-making culture and their ability to choose different approaches to make decisions of different magnitudes. And here, this is a classic example of a board actively and explicitly deciding how it will make this particular decision, and in doing so, reinforcing its overall culture of decision-making. So just you know, empowering people to raise their hand and say, well, this seems like a very challenging issue. Maybe we should think about having a supermajority requirement. And then another board member could say, well, Jamie, I disagree. I think this is a very straightforward issue. And now what a board is doing is talking about what it's going to talk about, gaining a sense of mastery over its one of its most important functions, which is decision-making. Another technique, which is pretty obvious and which many of us have experience with, but very few of us use in our board meetings, are secret ballots. Now, here I've got to make a caveat, which is, and this would apply to all of these techniques, some of you on this webinar may be public or district or county authority hospitals or governmental hospitals. And for some of you, and even for some types of not-for-profit private organizations, there are legal limitations on the types of vote you can take. So all of these techniques that I'm suggesting, you must make certain that they comport with the legal requirements for your decision-making. And the reason that I emphasize that here is frequently governmental hospitals are prohibited from taking secret ballots. The requirement is that the vote must be open and in open session and in public meetings, so that technique would not apply here. But the secret, you know, if it does apply to you, and for the vast majority of private, not-for-profit organizations, you can use this technique, and for the vast majority of for-profit organizations, you can also use this technique. Secret ballots, that's where a vote is taken, but it's not a public vote. It's not a hand-raising vote or a verbal vote, but rather it's done by secret ballot. And the benefit here is to allow board members to make difficult decisions when they're under close scrutiny or there is very serious concern about social, political, or economic repercussions or reprisals to the board for voting the way they're voting. And today, many boards, especially boards of rural hospitals or of tweener hospitals, you know, or standalone hospitals, the boards need to make decisions which the community is very invested in and very concerned about, closing services, consolidating clinical capacity. And these issues can have some very significant repercussions for board members who live and work in those communities. And the secret ballot technique is probably the one we're most familiar with in terms of an alternate approach to making decisions that can then take some of the heat off the individual board members, you know, for the vote. So, again, none of these techniques in and of themselves are earth-shattering. It's just the ability to use different techniques in different situations, which gives a board greater command over its own approach to decision-making and therefore greater control over its culture of decision-making, which will then help the board make better decisions for the good of the organization. And so, you know, if your board meetings are open to the public and it's permissible by law, the secret ballot technique can be very useful in that situation as well. There's one other kind of technique that it can be very, very useful, and this is drawn from decision theory, which is this emerging kind of area of social psychological research that looks at how individuals and how groups make decisions. And there's a kind of very interesting concept which has emerged and has been reinforced by several powerful studies, research, empirical studies, called decision fatigue. And what this says very simply is that the more decisions an individual makes or a board makes or a group makes, the more tired it will become and the quality of its decision making will deteriorate. So if you have a group making many decisions, it hits a certain point where it expends most of its energy and the quality of its decision-making begins to radically decline. Now, compare this concept, and you know, and it's more than a concept. It's, as I said, been empirically demonstrated in several studies, to how most board agendas are structured. And in most board agendas, the most pro forma, meaningless, boring, pettifogging nonsense is put at the beginning of the agenda, approval of minutes, you know, acknowledgement of receipt of reports, stuff like that. And the big issue, if there's one big decision that the board has to make that meeting, tends to be the last item on the agenda. And you may not think that voting to approve a couple of sets of minutes does anything, but the research is contrary to that view. It consumes your decision-making energy and contributes to decision fatigue. So another technique for good decision-making is to consciously attempt to avoid decision fatigue by flipping the script, by restructuring board agendas so that the biggest decision issue of the meeting appears first on the agenda. And the less meaningful, more routine pro forma decisions are put at the end of the agenda. And just such a simple technique, and it also does something else. It takes the single most important possession that a board has, its time together, and says we're going to spend our time on this big issue. And think of the reverse, the way the vast majority of boards do it now. If they take the big issue of the meeting and have it appear last on the agenda, if the agenda has run long, it's not at all uncommon to hear the chair say, well, we're running out of time. We've spent as much time as we can talking about this. Let's vote on it. And you end up with a very rushed decision. And that happens routinely. If you use this very simple technique, that's unlikely to happen. And if you spend the whole meeting talking about this big issue, the worst-case scenario is you don't approve the minutes or you don't make those other pro forma decisions, but you've invested the time in the most important issue the board is confronting for that meeting. So, once again, that's a very obvious technique, but when you compare it to the decision fatigue research, it really implies a board consciously recognizing its implicit culture of decision-making and trying to reverse it in the spirit of making better decisions for the organization. So simply flipping the script, put the big decision up front, put the smaller, less important decisions toward the end of the agenda, and restructure the board agenda accordingly can make a huge difference. So that's just a very, very simple technique. And when you take a look at all of these together, no one of them is earth-shattering. I would say the one that's got the biggest potential in and of itself to change the culture of board decision-making is the fist-to-five voting technique, because it completely moves you away from the binary yes or no decision-making culture of unanimity that most boards have, and also precipitates more meaningful conversation. But the other techniques are tools. They're just useful tools. So no one of them in and of itself is really earth-shattering, but it's the ability to choose, to be able to say, which decision requires or would benefit the most from which technique. Is this a major decision? Is this a minor decision? And then it just empowers the board to take more control over what its perhaps most important governance responsibility is, making decisions. Now, there's another technique which is especially useful for boards in systems or where there are multiple boards, where the issue of who has the authority to make the decision, comes up. Are we approving this decision? Are we simply recommending it? Are we just being asked to register an opinion, but our decision doesn't have any approval authority or force of law? And if any of those questions ever arise in your board meeting, who makes the final decision, for example? What are we being asked to do? It's very important to then have what's called an authority matrix. And this is just simply a cheat sheet. And frequently it's based on what's called a RACI model, R-A-C-I, which stands for recommend, approve, consult, or inform. And what that basically says is, what's your role in this decision? Is your role to make the final decision? If so, you'll be approved. You'll see an A under board. Is your role to recommend to a higher authority? Let's say you're a medical executive committee and you're making a recommendation about medical staff credentialing. You don't make the decision. You make the recommendation to the hospital board, and the hospital board makes the ultimate decision. So if you had an authority matrix and it said recommend privileges, that would be the medical executive committee's role, R for recommend, whereas the board role would be A for approve. And what the authority matrix does is it just simply prospectively outlines every decision that is going to flow from one group to another and specifically clarifies whose job it is to do what, so that you take away ambiguity and confusion, and then you can also align your decision-making culture with the actual legal requirements. As an example, it's very, very common to this day to hear medical executive committee members use this phrase: the medical executive committee decided to reappoint Dr. Smith. No, they didn't. They recommended. The board makes the ultimate decision. Now, that may sound like a very small point, but language reflects culture, and the language of decision-making must be consistent with the legal authority of the group making the decision. So the culture must be consistent with the authority, and the use of the authority matrix is a very, very useful, powerful technique to align the culture with the authority and to kind of remove confusion or ambiguity in the decision-making process. So I've outlined for you several different techniques in decision-making for boards. Some of them may be more useful to your board than others, but if you experiment with them and just talk about with them, you will find that it changes your approach to decision-making, makes it much more conscious, much more explicit, which then gives the board or whichever decision-making group is using these techniques more power over their own processes. And all of these things together then combine to result in better decision-making for the good of the organization. So I hope that this is useful to you, and I would love any feedback from those of you who try some of these techniques or experiment with others. So please feel free to let me know how these work for you or if you have other techniques to suggest so that we can communicate them to the field. Thank you very much for your kind attention, and good luck and good governance.